Alan Wakefield is the head of First World War and Early 20th Century Conflict at Imperial War Museums, where he leads the curatorial team charged with interpreting and developing the hugely varied collection of material covering the period 1900 to 1929. He is a member of both the British Commission for Military History and the Western Front Association. As the chair of the Salonika Campaign Society and a recognized authority on British involvement in the Salonika Campaign from 1915 to 1918, Wakefield has lectured and contributed to publications in the United Kingdom and overseas on aspects of the Salonika Campaign and other First World War-related subjects. His Salonika Campaign-related publications and papers include Under the Devil's Eye, Britain's Forgotten Army at Salonika, 1915 to 1918. The British Way in Warfare, Salonika, 1915 to 1918. Cameras with the British Salonika Force, and most recently, The Armies in the Landscape, the Allied Military Presence in the Kilkees Prefecture, 1915 to 1918, which was featured in Archaeology in Times of War in Kilkees, from the War Trenches to the Excavation Trenches. Friends, please welcome Alan Wakefield.
Thanks, Hayley. Thanks for that introduction. And thanks for the invitation to come and talk to you today about Salonika, one of the sort of forgotten campaigns of the First World War, especially in Western Europe and overseas. Obviously, for those nations in the Balkans, this was their First World War. This was their big thing. So it really depends on where you are geographically in how far this campaign has been forgotten or sort of sidelined. So I'm going to try sharing my PowerPoint presentation and hopefully we can get underway. Great. Okay, so my paper today, I'm going to look at the origins of the campaign. Some of the defining features of the campaign, which really made it so sort of cosmopolitan, both in terms of the people that were involved and the sort of landscape and terrain that the campaign was actually fought across. We'll then go through the sort of course and conclusion of the campaign. Because it is quite a forgotten campaign, we sort of need to do this sort of chronology going through, because even, as I say, for a lot of people in Britain, this is pretty much a pretty obscure area. So it's quite funny when we think of the First World War. The First World War started in the Balkans, but the region quickly became very much a strategic backwater, as the major combatant powers concentrated their forces on the Western and Eastern fronts. However, in 1915, the Balkans becomes a major focal point for both the Allies and the Central Powers. And this is because in 1915, both sides are trying to bring new nations into the war on their side, and they're looking to have some strategic advantages away from the main theatres of war, where the war is starting to bog down, especially in the West, where you've got trench deadlock. The catalyst for this concentration on the Balkans is the Anglo-French attack on the Dardanelles, which became the Gallipoli campaign and went on from April to December 1915. And as the fighting at Gallipoli dragged on through 1915, the Germans needed to establish a secure railway supply route across Europe so they could get munitions and supplies to their hard-pressed Ottoman allies. Now, if you can see on this map, with Romania and Bulgaria neutral and Serbia still on the Allied side, the Germans were blocked. And what they decide to do in 1915, the first thing is to knock Serbia out of the war, to start this process of getting a supply route across the Balkans with territory that they control. However, the Germans and Austro-Hungarians are very heavily engaged on the Eastern Front at this time, and it can't be until the autumn of 1915 that they can contemplate attacking Serbia. And included in German planning is the involvement of Bulgaria. They really need the Bulgarians to come in because the Austro-Hungarians and Germans haven't really got enough troops to definitely knock Serbia out of the war. They need Bulgarian assistance. Now, interestingly, with Bulgaria, she is neutral in 1914 into 1915, and what she's basically doing is sitting on the fence, because what the Bulgarians are trying to do is to reverse a territorial settlement from the Second Balkan War. So 1912, 1913, the Bulgarians are involved in two wars in the Balkans. Firstly, 1912 against the Turks, alongside the Greeks, Montenegrins and Serbians, which they win. Unfortunately, the Bulgarians don't get as much territory out of this war as they think they should have done. And what they really want, I don't know if you can see my cursor here, what they really want is this area here of southern Macedonia, which was given to Serbia in 1912. They see it as an ethnic Bulgarian area that they want. So they launch an attack on Serbia in 1913, and literally all the other Balkan nations, including the Turks, pitch in against them and defeat them. And there's a settlement called the Treaty of Bucharest, in which the Bulgarians lose even more territory. So what they're looking to do is to reverse that. Now, for the Allies, it's very difficult to reverse this treaty, because that territory that the Bulgarians really want is held by Serbia, who are an allied country. So they try to say to the Serbs, okay, sorry, to the Bulgarians, okay, we'll give you some Turkish territory at the end of the war when we've defeated the Ottoman Empire. So the Bulgarians would have to wait to get this territory. And the Allies hope that these promises will at least keep Bulgaria neutral. Against this, the Central Powers, of course, are in a much better position. They want to defeat and occupy Serbia so they can offer the Bulgarians all of the territory they want in Serbia. The Germans say they'll also cut a deal with the Ottomans so that some of the Ottoman territory in Europe to the south of Bulgaria here will also be ceded to Bulgaria, and Bulgaria will even get access to the Adriatic Sea. So the Bulgarians are sort of wavering at this point, but looking at the German offer, it's hell of a lot better, to be honest. And the war isn't going well for the Allies at this time. On the Eastern Front, the Gorlice-Tarnow offensive has been a huge defeat for the Russians. They've lost hundreds of thousands of soldiers, have been pushed back and pushed out of Russian Poland. So it doesn't look good on the Eastern Front. On the Western Front, there's continuous deadlock, and there's deadlock at Gallipoli. So the Bulgarians think there's a chance the Central Powers may win the war in 1915. And on the 6th of September, they conclude a secret convention with the Central Powers, where they agree to provide 25% of the military force that will invade Serbia, and to come into that campaign against Serbia 5 days after the Germans and Austro-Hungarians attack towards Belgrade from the north. At the same time, Allied leaders are completely out of touch with this situation. For instance, on the 16th of September, Maurice Hankey, who we see here, Secretary of the War Cabinet, believes that simply the landing of a token Allied military force in Greece will deter Bulgaria from going to war. But on the 22nd of September, Bulgaria mobilizes her army. Around this time, the Greeks and Serbians call for 150,000 Allied soldiers to operate against Bulgaria. Now, this is basically equating to a number of soldiers that was laid down in a Greek-Serbian defense agreement in 1913. And this was a mutual defense agreement that either side, if attacked, would get assistance from the other side. So at the moment, we're looking at Serbia is going to be attacked, so the Greeks should be going to their assistance. But the pact says that so the Greeks can attack Bulgaria, the Serbians have to send an armed force to assist them directly. They obviously can't do this because they're waiting for the Germans and Austrians to cross the border near Belgrade. So they call for Allied soldiers instead. And this is somewhat of a problem for the British and French, because they haven't really got those forces to hand. And Foreign Secretary Sir Edward Grey states that only a small contingent of troops can be sent. At the same time, of course, we've got stalemate at Gallipoli, things aren't going well, and there's very few people in the British government or military favour continuing or even more intervention in the Balkan region. But French pledges of direct support for Serbia, backing up her political and economic friendship with Serbia, are tying allied hands here. And with the Russians and Italians supporting the French position, the British find themselves locked into a policy of committing troops to the Balkans. But many people in the British government and military hope, as Hanke does, that the situation will remain of small scale. It will be a small scale intervention and of short duration. But this, of course, proves wildly optimistic. And on the 13th of October 1915, Bulgaria declares war on Serbia, and the Allies are committed to sending troops into Greece. Now, the arrival of British and French troops begins on the 5th of October 1915, and they come into the Greek port of Salonika. And this is just a day before the Germans invade Serbia from the north. The Allied force has been invited to land by the pro-Allied Greek Prime Minister Venizelos. And amazingly, he'd managed to get King Constantine to agree to mobilize the Greek army and call on Allied military assistance. But this meeting of minds quickly collapses, and just prior to the Allied troops' arrival, Venizelos resigns from office. The new Greek government that comes in, although neutral, has a pro-German stance, and this is really following the policy of King Constantine and his general staff. And this fatal split between Venizelos and King Constantine sets in motion what becomes known in Greece as the national schism, and it blights Greek politics for years ahead. Now, for the Allies, if they are going to support Serbia directly with military forces, the only option is to use Salonika, the port of Salonika, because it is the only large, well-developed deep water port in the region. It has mainline railways, which allow the quick movement of men, equipment, and supplies north towards Serbia. And the port's location at the head of the Gulf of Salonika is easily defendable against any naval attack from the Austro-Hungarian Navy, it would be, who were in the Adriatic. The first Allied troops to arrive come from Gallipoli, two divisions, that's one French, one British. And they're selected simply because they're the closest military formations that are available. There's no special reason why these troops are going there. They're just the closest forces to send there as quickly as possible. On the 14th of October, the French send a second division directly from France. 2 days before that division arrives, General Maurice Serai lands at Salonika to command the French troops. Now, his arrival is really a political move. Serai was a darling of the radical socialists in France, whose support was vital to the then French government. And he had to be found a command after being dismissed from command of the Third French Army in July 1915. He was offered the command of two French divisions at Gallipoli, but argued that this would be a demotion as he was an army commander, not just commanding two divisions. And he gets the French government to say, okay, we'll actually have a 6th Division force at Gallipoli and you can command them. But the unfolding strategic situation means that Serai never arrives at Gallipoli. And instead, this most political of generals ends up in neutral Greece at Salonika. Now, from the time of his arrival until mid-November 1915, Serai tasks the French force to keep a line of retreat open for the Serbian army towards Greece. But this is very much beyond the capabilities of that French force, as by the 24th of October, the Bulgarian Second Army has effectively cut off the Serbians from their allies who are coming north. We can see here the French and British get up to about this area here, but the Bulgarian Second Army is already sweeping round through Skopje. And the Serbians are then getting surrounded in Kosovo. Whilst the French are advancing rapidly into southern Serbia, The British, under Sir Brian Mahon, are stuck just outside Salonika in camp because the British government hopes that simply the mere presence of this Allied force will galvanize the Greeks into attacking Bulgaria. But this obviously is not going to happen. And finally, the British wake up to this in late October, and Mahon receives orders from London to cross into Serbia and directly support the French. A month later, the Serbians are in dire straits, and their government and army are beginning their epic march from Kosovo over the mountains into Albania and down to the Adriatic coast, where they will be rescued by the Allied fleets and taken to the island of Corfu to rebuild. And the government will stay there as a government in exile. At that point, the Bulgarian Second Army turns its attention to the French and the British. In contact with the Bulgarians since late October, the French begin a fighting retreat down the Vardar Valley on the 3rd of December 1915. And 4 days later, the 10th Irish Division, which is at Costarino, are attacked by the Bulgarians in overwhelming numbers and forced back after losing heavy casualties. And by the 14th of December, the Allied force is retreating into Greece towards Salonika. Now, 10 days earlier, a decision was taken on what would be the future of this Allied force in the Balkans. And the meeting of British and French war leaders at Calais saw Britain argue that the defeat of Serbia removed any rationale for a continued intervention in the Balkans. And this appeared to be winning ground. The French seemed to agree to this. Yet 2 days later at Chantilly, another meeting, the British find themselves isolated as the French side with the Serbians, Russians, and Italians in stating that a military presence in the Balkans ensures Greek neutrality and also shows a firm commitment to the regions at the same time as the Allies are trying to bring Romania into the war. So they found another rationale to keep troops there. And because we're fighting a coalition war, the British can't get out of their commitment and end up being committed to five army divisions in Salonika as part of this multinational force. With this decision taken, they have to defend the port of Salonika because they think the Bulgarians are going to invade Greece and push down towards the port. And without the harbour at Salonika remaining outside of artillery range of the Bulgarians, we're in real trouble. It'll be very difficult to evacuate troops in that area and very difficult to reinforce what we've already got on the ground. So we decide to build a huge 70-mile line of defences. Now, the terrain about 10 miles north of Salonika is very good for this. There's a load of foothills. Those of you who come on the tour will actually see some of the surviving defences there. It was ideal for sighting defences. However, they had to get Greek agreement to this. And what they do is they threaten economic sanctions and a naval blockade of Greece to get the government of King Constantine to agree that Salonika could be fortified by the Allies and all Greek troops, apart from those defending the harbour, are moved out of this defended zone. So you've now got an area of neutral Greece, which is literally under Allied military control. Now, interestingly, the one thing about this defence line, it took them 4 months to build, and they used hundreds and hundreds of miles of barbed wire. And that led the British troops, with their typical humour, to nickname this the birdcage line, because it was almost like they were caged in behind these barbed wire defences. But of course, these defences were never tested. As I've mentioned, the Germans put pressure on the Bulgarians not to invade Greece because they fear it will knock Greece into the war on the Allied side. The Germans are also happy to see British and French troops committed to the Balkans long term because it keeps them away from the Western Front, which is great for the Germans. Finally, they're also worried about the Bulgarians. They feel that if the war comes to an end in the Balkans and the Bulgarians get their territorial settlement that they went to war to actually pursue, Bulgaria will drop out of the war. And that potentially threatens this communications line across the Balkans to the Ottoman Empire. So by keeping an allied force in Greece threatening Bulgaria, it keeps Bulgaria in the war. So quite a few things there that the Germans are doing to actually keep this front active for their strategic benefit. Now, as reinforcements arrived in Salonika, Allied reinforcements are coming in during 1916, the Allied hold on the city tightens. At the end of December, General Sarai decides to shut down the consulates of the Central Powers. Remember, this is a Greek neutral city, so the enemy consulates are still functioning. There are agents at the docks, literally marking down every soldier, every gun, every supplies that come in. They're going back to their consulates, and all this information is getting wired to Berlin, Vienna, etc. So he shuts that down, shuts that enemy network of information down. The 22nd of January 1916, Sarai seizes the Greek fort at Karaburun Point, which defends the entrance to the Gulf of Salonika. The Greeks complain, but obviously don't threaten the Allies because it would be a situation of war, which they can't take. And on the 3rd of June 1916, Sarai declares a state of siege in Salonika because the Greeks have handed over a fortress at the head of the Struma Valley to the Bulgarians. So he uses that as an excuse to actually take over Salonika itself. So by this time, Salonika is an occupied city under Allied military control. And by 1917, it's the administrative and logistical centre for around 600,000 Allied soldiers. From January 16, that Allied force is designated the Army d'Orient, and it's under French command. So initially, it's under the command of General Sarai. The main reason it's under French command is that the British really have no interest in this front, so they don't put up a rival candidate to be CNC. They leave it to the French because the British are always sort of looking to get out of this theatre of war if they can. So until his replacement in December 17, Sarai is commanding a military force comprising six national contingents, and we can see many of them here: French, British, Serbian, Russian, Italian, and Greek. And further diversifying these forces are soldiers from India, modern-day Vietnam, and North and West Africa. That's within the British and the French sections of this force. Now, although it appeared strong on paper, the Allied force did suffer a number of deficiencies that undermined its ability to undertake sustained military operations. And chief amongst these was a lack of combat manpower. The British and the Italians refused to send additional troops to Salonika, and the British were always looking to scale down their commitment. Although the British Salonika force, as it was called, the BSF, at its peak numbered 228,000 soldiers, only 94,500 of those were actually fighting troops. And in 1917, the BSF loses two divisions to Palestine, where the British focus is now going as a chance for a potentially easy victory away from the Western Front. And then, following the German offensives in the spring of 1918 on the Western Front, another 12 divisions, sorry, 12 battalions of British soldiers are taken from Salonika and sent back to France. And for the Italians, wresting control of Albania from the Austro-Hungarians is more important to them strategically and diplomatically than contributing to overall success in the Balkans. So, beyond the 45,000 strong 35th Division, no Italian troops join the Allied force at Salonika. Now, the French have also got problems with the numbers serving in their eight divisions at Salonika. From the spring of 1917, metropolitan French soldiers have the right of home leave and the option not to return to Macedonia if they've served 18 months continuously in the field. This immediately placed 45,000 French soldiers in line for repatriation to France, and replacements had to be found. But as with the British, the requirements of the Western Front always came first. So it was quite difficult to find enough French replacements. So a greater call comes on the French Army of Africa. Now, colonial soldiers aren't under those same leave stipulations as the soldiers actually from France itself. But again, as with the British, in the spring of 1918, the French lose 10,000 men sent back to the Western Front to make good those losses from those German offensives. But it's not just the British, French, and Italians who have manpower problems. The Russians and Serbians likewise have issues. There are two Russian brigades arriving in the autumn of 1916. They number 20,000 men and they fight alongside the French and Serbs west of the Vardar River. But unfortunately, many of the replacements coming out from Russia to fill the places of casualties are found to be very pro-Bolshevik and undermine the reliability of the brigades. In fact, so much that in January 1918, the Russian contingent is actually disbanded, and only a few hundred men fight on in the French Foreign Legion in Salonika. The rest of these guys are disarmed and put into labor battalions, and some of the real hardline Bolsheviks are actually sent to French North Africa to sit out the rest of the war. For the Serbian army, they're of course been exiled from their totally occupied homeland. So they don't have a population from which to recruit reinforcements. Their army, which was re-established on Corfu from survivors of the Great Trek across Albania, numbered 6,000 officers and 124,000 men, and it comes to Salonika in early 1916. But they were heavily involved in the fighting of 19 later in 16 and in 1917 and suffered heavy casualties. So by October 1917, it's estimated the frontline strength for the Serbian army was only 20,000 men. The army survives as a fighting force because in 1918, a further 20,000 men arrive. These are former Austro-Hungarian prisoners of war and men from Serbian diaspora populations from all over the world, including the USA. They all come as volunteers to fight for the Serbian cause. Now, the only Allied contingent that grows in manpower terms during the campaign is the Greeks. Although not formally at war until June 1917, the Greeks had served alongside the Allies from October 1916, as Venizelos forms a provisional government, pro-Allied provisional government at Salonika. So from that time, October 16, you have two rival governments in Greece. He raises his own army, about 40,000 volunteers of the National Defence Corps. And they, as I say, fight alongside the British and French from late 1916 onwards. By July 1918, this 40,000-man force is augmented by 160,000 men of the regular Greek army. This is once Greece has come into the war. But the Greek army was never employed to its full potential, as many of the Allied commanders view the force with some suspicion. And this is a legacy of the many mutinies that plagued the mobilization process in areas of Greece that were still loyal to King Constantine. So there's not full trust in the whole of that Greek regular army. Coupled to those manpower shortages are problems for the British, particularly in artillery. And this was down to the low priority placed on Salonika by the War Office at home in the overall British war effort. In addition, the British and French have to supply all the other national contingents. The Serbian army is rebuilt, totally re-equipped by the French in 1916. Motor transport and medical units come from the British army. In addition, the British and French have a responsibility to equip the Venizelos forces with artillery transport medical units. The Russian brigades have to have French artillery, and the Greek regulars, when they come in, receive artillery and aircraft from the British and French. It's a huge call on resources for the British and French in what is really a minor theatre for both of those major powers. Now, facing the Allies in Macedonia are about 500,000 soldiers representing all four of the Central Powers. But the overwhelming number of them are, of course, Bulgarians. This is the main theatre of war for Bulgaria. Although the Bulgarian army is sufficiently equipped to fight the Serbians in 1915-1916, as the war lengthens, the lack of any real military industrial base in Bulgaria means that they're increasingly reliant on Germany for weaponry, ammunition, and even uniforms. Now, the Germans, as with their other allies, they do support Bulgaria with major reinforcements at times of necessity. But such deployments are often dependent on strategic situation overall in all theatres of war, and these priorities that these may call. So they're only a short term to bolster the line to stop any Allied attacks, and they withdraw these troops to either the Eastern or the Western fronts. Alongside these infantry reinforcements, they do leave on the Salonika front for most of the war, artillery units, machine gun companies, and engineers. And these specialists are really there to improve the firepower and fighting efficiency of the Bulgarian army. In contrast, the Austro-Hungarians only really send specialists such as machine gun and assault companies. They're so heavily pressed on the Italian and Eastern fronts, they literally don't have anything else they can send to assist the Bulgarians. And finally, there are between October 16 and July 1917, two Ottoman divisions fighting in the Struma Valley. This 40,000 strong contingent is quickly reinforced by large numbers of local Turks, because we have to remember this region until 1912 was part of the Ottoman Empire. The population is very, very mixed, and lots of the local Muslim population flock to join this Turkish force. Now, the presence of Ottoman troops in Macedonia was brokered by the Germans. It's not welcomed by the Bulgarians. They're very suspicious of their old enemy, but they're forced to accept this assistance out of necessity. They have to take these guys on. Now, in terms of the front that the Salonika campaign is fought along, it varies greatly in its terrain, from the wide open valleys and plains to tangled hills and ravines and the towering Beleš and Maglena mountains. And this means that there's highly different types of warfare, both offensive and defensive, depending on where the troops are serving. For example, the French and Serbians are concentrated west of the Vardar River, and for a significant part of their front, they face the tall, towering Moglena Mountains. The British, their front is really cut in two. They've got 70 miles of line, and they have the maze of hills, ridges, and ravines above Lake Doiran and the large, wide expanse of the Struma Valley. And with military formations on both sides holding the same sectors of front for long periods of time, the wartime experience of soldiers in Macedonia varies greatly. Even though geographically they're not very far apart, they're fighting quite often very, very different types of war. Climatically, this is a difficult area, and it tended summer and winter extremes tends to mean that most active military operations happen in the spring and autumn. In the summer, there are temperatures up to 113 Fahrenheit in the shade, and the heat brings swarms of insects which carries disease. There's great problems maintaining water supplies, so a lot is done by engineers to maintain an adequate military water system. In the winter, it's totally the opposite, and the troops experience snow, freezing winds, blizzards, severe hailstorms, and heavy rain. And with most troops accommodated in dugouts, bivouacs, and tents, the conditions in winter were very primitive, and it generally became a losing battle against the elements. On top of this, the Salonika campaign was very much an old-fashioned campaign where casualties due to disease far outweighed those from enemy action. For example, British non-battle casualties in the campaign were 481,000, which is 20 times the level of battle casualties. And of this level, 162,500 were malaria cases. The French, too, suffer high levels of malaria, 96,000 cases. But the local troops, the local forces, Bulgarians, Serbs, Greeks, etc., much lower rates of malaria. For the Bulgarians, for example, only 21,000 cases recorded. And this was largely down to some of the troops having levels of immunity to the disease acquired during childhood. Unfortunately, the campaign in some areas was fought across areas which were very, very good breeding grounds for malaria-carrying mosquitoes. The worst example being that wide, flat Struma Valley held by the British, which was actually abandoned during the summer months because the malaria problems were so bad. Both sides used to move back into the foothills and leave the valley as a massive expanse of no man's land. Now, to combat the malaria problems, a number of preventative measures were undertaken. There was a drainage of marshland, the straightening of water courses, the construction of mosquito-proof huts, and the provision of netting for tents and bivouacs. Protective clothing like this was also issued, and frontline troops were doused regularly with quinine to try to keep malaria rates down. But none of this really worked, and malaria was a problem throughout the campaign. Now, they also had a problem, the Allies at least, with their line of communication to get supplies and troops in. It was a very long, vulnerable sea line of communication through the Mediterranean, and British, French, Italian, and even Japanese naval forces were used to defend merchant shipping against U-boat attack. But it wasn't until May 1918 that monthly shipping losses dipped below 100,000 tons. You can see how successful those German and Austrian U-boats actually were. Resupply comes very, very difficult in 1917. The German U-boats are doing so well in the Atlantic that there aren't enough troops to keep the troops on the Western Front supplied and those in Salonika and further afield. So it becomes very difficult to supply the forces in Salonika and almost impossible to take the sick and wounded out of theatre. And this means that in October 1917, they establish an overland route, which means that you'll get your troops to travel across Greece to the Adriatic, cross the Adriatic by boat to Taranto, and then use railway lines in Italy and France to reach the Channel ports and then the British home across the Channel. So a hell of a long journey there for troops trying to go home on leave or sending sick men home or getting reinforcements out. Within theatre, the railways, not great. They're under Greek control initially, and they're certainly not up to dealing with a massive military campaign. And a lot of work has to be done to improve these. These are supplemented by narrow gauge lines, these Decaville railways, helping to bring supplies and ammunition close to the front line. They also have problems with the roads. Very few of them are metalled, and none of them, again, are capable of supporting the level of transport needed in the campaign. By the end of the campaign, the Allies have had to construct 300 miles of metalled road on almost 200 miles of secondary road. But despite this increase in mechanisation of the transport system, many frontline units are still reliant on mule supply, on mule transport for their resupply. And the mule is really the unsung hero of the Salonika campaign. So returning to the course of the campaign now in late, well, mid-1916, with no Bulgarian attack on Salonika, the Allied forces start to move north. And the French are the first to go. The British, as usual, are lagging behind, not really wanting to get involved in this. But it's decided in 1916 that there will be simultaneous attacks on the Central Powers on the Eastern, Western, and Italian fronts. And as such, they need some activity in the Balkans to hopefully keep German troops that are there on this front and hopefully try to drag in some more of the German forces. At the same time, the British have a change in command. General Mahon is sent off to Egypt and he's replaced by Major General Sir George Milne. Milne brings experience in the Western Front, and he's also seen as somebody who is more able to deal with Sarai, as he has a strength of will and firmness that the British government think that Mahon is lacking. And in fact, Sarai does actually say that he believes Marne was removed from his command for being too pro-French. And Milne quickly stands up to Sarai and quickly finds that Sarai is not really a man that he can work with particularly successfully. Now, in the summer of 1916, the French, who are hard pressed at Verdun, get agreement with the British finally to launch an offensive in the Balkans. And they're also trying to bring in Romania at this time. So the idea is that this will not only hopefully suck German troops away from Verdun and bring them into the Balkans, but it will also help the Romanians attack Austro-Hungary through Transylvania. So the idea is they're going to go from east to west into the Hungarian lands. But this is preempted by the Bulgarians, who actually advance into Greece through Monastir and then down from Fort Rupel to Serres and Kavala. And this move is not countered by the Greeks. Constantine keeps his country neutral, and that's why Venizelos sets up this provisional government, because he's outraged by the fact that the Greek government has not done anything at all. Sarai's offensive begins in September 1916, and by the 2nd of October, the Allies have managed to retake all the ground seized by the Bulgarians who advanced towards Monastir. They haven't recaptured any of that ground in Struma, but in the west, they have retaken the ground. Sarai's army, primarily the French and the Serbians, are now going to advance to try to capture Monastir and get onto Serbian territory. And a big part of this is going to be played by the Serbian army advancing through the Maglena Mountains. And on the 30th of September, after 2 weeks bitter fighting, the Serbs seize the heavily fortified Mount Kaimachalan and push on into Serbian territory. The operations are interrupted by torrential rain, but when they resume in early November, Sarai concentrates his outflanking attack on the Bulgarian position. And by the 19th of November, Monastir is liberated. And this is a huge morale boost for the Serbs, because this puts the Serbians back on home territory for the first time since they were expelled in 1915. And it's a real morale boosting lift. But winter weather comes along, and on the 11th of December, Sarai is forced to shut down the offensive. It's been very costly. 50,000 Allied casualties, mainly French and Serbian, and 60,000 for the Bulgarians. And despite the capture of Monastir, Sarai's offensive has failed to achieve a breakthrough and does little to stop the Romanians being quickly knocked out of the war. Now, there is a chance that Sarai thinks there's another chance in 1917 for another attack, and he launches another offensive with British consent in 1917, in April 1917. But Lloyd George, Prime Minister Lloyd George, warns him that if there is no major success here, the British are going to withdraw forces from Salonika and send them elsewhere. This offensive is a total failure. The British are forced to attack at Doiran twice in support of the attack, and it's pretty much a bloodbath for the British. The main offensive is shut down within 2 weeks for losses of 14,000 men. And really, this is the end of the road for General Sarai. By this time, he's lost support of all the commanders of the Allied contingents in Salonika. None of them support him. And he's also lost support in the French government, as in November 1917, Georges Clemenceau takes power, and he is no fan of Sarai. He doesn't need to keep him in his position. He doesn't need the radical socialists to help his government out. And on the 10th of December 1917, Sarai is informed that he will be replaced as commander in Salonika by General Guillaumin. Now, General Guillaumin, he's only in post for 6 months, but he greatly improves command and control structures within the Allied forces in Salonika. He establishes a true Allied GHQ, with staff officers from all the national contingents working fully on intelligence and operational planning. And he also rebuilds the relationship with his fellow Allied commanders through his very consultative leadership style. He's always going around asking the other commanders what they want to do and asking for their opinion, which is something Sarai never did. Guilliman also prepares a report on offensive opportunities in Macedonia. And the idea being that although this isn't going to be a major offensive area for the Allies, if there's an option to do it, we will attack to keep that pressure up on the Central Powers. But the attack will be one of successive thrusts along different parts of the front, allowing each attack to employ the greatest concentration of artillery, aircraft and transport. When Guillemard returns to France, he is a major advocate for an offensive in Salonika. And between July and September 1918, he talks to the British, French and the Italians and pushes this idea of a major offensive potential in the Balkans. By June of 1918, the French are already up for this anyway, and it's just really pushing the British and Italians to get on side. And the new commander, the man who comes in, the final commander in the Balkans, is General Louis Franchet Desperet, nicknamed Desperate Frankie by the British. He knows the Balkans very well. He travelled there extensively before the First World War, and he even prepared a paper in 1914 for the French General Staff on the strategic benefits of an Allied offensive in the Balkans. He inherited the command and control machinery established by his predecessor, which enabled him to effectively use the Allied army as a unified tool and to bring offensive plans to reality within 3 months. Now, his offensive, when it was relaunched, was very different from that envisaged by Guillemont. He met Field Marshal Misic at Serbian GHQ in June, and this provided the operational concept. And this was to be a strike, a concentrated rapid strike by the French and Serbian army through the Moglena Mountains into the open country beyond. And it offered terrain, and it was through terrain where the Bulgarians wouldn't really have any opportunity to establish strong lines of defence. The rail hubs of Gradsko and Krivolak, marked on the map in red here, 35 miles behind the front, were the main objectives. After capturing these, their forces would push on towards Velez and Skopje, where they would cut the Bulgarian front in half and force a general retreat, or lead to the Bulgarians being surrounded and cut off from home. For success, stress was placed on the rapid breakthrough and exploitation and turning the breakthrough into a rapid pursuit. To tie down Bulgarian forces on a wider front, secondary attacks would be made by French, Italian, Greek and British forces to the east and west of the main strike. Now, by this time, the Bulgarians are in a pretty bad state. They were on reduced rations caused by poor harvests and the export of agricultural produce to Germany. There's a growing shortage of war materials, including boots and uniforms, and the worsening conditions at the front, and news coming from families at home of equally dire situations are undermining soldiers' morale. But despite warnings from the Bulgarian sea commander-in-chief of the increasingly bad state of his army, the Germans withdraw 90,000 of their men. That's two-thirds of the men they have in the Balkans. They withdraw them in 1918 as Hindenburg and Ludendorff are gambling everything on victory in the West. A victory in the West means it doesn't matter what happens on the Salonika front. The war will be over. Germany will win. But as the spring turns to summer in 1918, the confidence in a German victory is vastly declining amongst the Bulgarian soldiers and the government in Sofia. And on the morning of the 14th of September 1918, the largest artillery bombardment of the campaign heralds the start of the Allied offensive. Desperet and Misic have managed to put together a 3-to-1 superiority in infantry and artillery, concentrated on that key part of the front in the Moglena Mountains. All three mountain peaks, Dobropolje, Sokol and Vetranik, were in French and Serbian hands by the close of the 15th of September, despite hard Bulgarian fighting. Fighting for the Bulgarian second line occupied just the next day, but again the Bulgarians were unable to hold, and a 15-mile breach is actually forced in their front line. Matters deteriorate further the following day as Bulgarian units start to withdraw without giving any warning to units on their flanks, and the resulting gaps are exploited quickly by the Serbians. Lacking transport to quickly withdraw their artillery or move reserves into points of danger, and with insufficient German units to bolster their increasingly demoralised infantry, the Bulgarian army's position by the 18th of September was desperate. Only at Doiran did highly motivated troops hold their ground and inflict heavy casualties on the Greeks and British. But even the defenders of Doiran were forced to retreat on the 20th of September due to the momentum of the main Allied offensive. And we can see here this road clogged with Bulgarian soldiers streaming back from the front line on the 21st of September. Senior German commanders hoped the Allied advance would falter as the lines of communication lengthened and allow attacks to be launched by on the Franco-Serbian flanks. So they're almost creating a salient as they attack, and they're hoping they can pinch this out. But it doesn't work because the whole front is now collapsing, and the French, Italian, Greek and British troops are also advancing, which puts any idea of a counterattack by the Bulgarians out of action. Attempts to defend Gradsko and Krivolak fail, and these are taken on the 24th of September. Awakening now to the seriousness of the situation, the Germans and Austro-Hungarians begin moving troops towards Macedonia. But unlike earlier in the campaign, this assistance was arriving too late to save the situation. With the army falling apart, senior Bulgarian commanders urged their government to conclude an armistice, and the decision for peace was taken on the 25th of September, 1918. But that same day, the lead elements of the British Salonika force crossed the Bulgarian frontier near Kostorino. This is the same place British forces first encountered the Bulgarians back in 1915. And with air supremacy, this British pursuit of the retreating Bulgarian army is only slowed down by its logistical system, the British logistical system, which is close to breaking point by this time. The following day near Strumica, Bulgarian armistice delegates cross the British front line and are sent to meet Desperet at Salonika. The armistice is signed at 2300 hours on the 29th of September and came into effect on noon the following day. With Bulgaria defeated, Desperet envisaged an invasion of southern Germany through Austria-Hungary. But Allied war leaders want to finish the war quickly on the Western Front. However, the Army d'Orion did have a pretty impressive war record by 1918. And by November, it had liberated Serbia, had crossed the Danube into Romania, and had helped force an armistice on the Ottomans. Given these results, perhaps the Salonika campaign is best viewed as a third Balkan war, albeit one originating from strategic considerations of world war. And whilst the campaign did not directly defeat Germany, its outcome clearly indicated to German war leaders such as Ludendorff that they had lost the war. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan, for that fantastic lecture. Friends, we will now start our Q&A session, so please feel free to type those into the chat or the Q&A box. We'll begin with a question about, you know, the types of the diseases that soldiers endured during the campaign, like malaria. Given the harsh conditions in Salonika, what other diseases were an issue, and was influenza one of them?
Yeah, the other key disease is there's quite a lot of dysentery, because especially in the summer months, you have swarms of flies. Flies go to some nasty places, then they land on your food, then you eat your food, and unfortunately you go down with dysentery, which is pretty unpleasant. Influenza is a major issue in 1918, that sort of pandemic that spreads across the world. In fact, for the Second Battle of Doiran, the British are forced to take a complete infantry brigade out of the line because most of the men are down with influenza, and they literally can't fight. And we have to remember that many of the soldiers that get influenza are already weakened by recurrent malaria. So there's that great problem of you've already got weakened men of weakened physique who are then hit by the influenza epidemic as well. And it does disable lots and lots of soldiers. So yeah, influenza definitely comes in at the end.
Question from Ramsey Miller. Do you feel that Greece's position during the war changed from central power support to allied, more from observing modern warfare and realizing that the allied powers were better long term on the world stage? Or do you feel it was more because of the terms that they were given by the allies?
I really think it's more the Allied growing Allied pressure on Greece. Once you get down to they've had the naval fleet seized, they are blockaded. There are areas of Greece that are reaching starvation point because we're blockading food supplies to get into Greece while King Constantine is still in power, and in the end, it's this constant pressure that forces the Greeks to change, and Constantine is forced to go into exile. The new government coming in, there is only one way to go, and it is to join the Allied cause, to get rid of these economic problems. By 1917, I think also the Greeks can sort of see which way the wind is blowing in the war. And we have to remember that for the Greeks are a maritime power. They're always more worried about what's happening at sea than what's happening on the land frontier of Greece. That means the British and French naval power, and Italian naval power, in fact, in the Mediterranean, is always more of a concern to the Greeks than Bulgarian German land power. Bulgaria was totally the other way around. Bulgaria is basically a land power with some outlet to the sea. So Bulgaria is more like what's happening on the land, strategically land-based. Greece is always looking more outward maritime-wise. So in a way, I think Greece is always going to end up either being a friendly neutral to the Allies or coming in on the Allied side.
I do want to be mindful of your time, Alan. We are
That's fine. I'm fine.
almost
I'm okay.
okay, great. So you're comfortable with staying on for at least 10 more minutes because we've got a few more questions. Wonderful. Let's see. Mark asks, were the Ottoman Turks involved in the last year or two of these battles?
No, what happens with those Ottoman forces is that in I think it's about mid 17, they're sent to Palestine. By this time, the British pressure in Palestine is really building, and Palestine is seen as the place that the Ottomans really need to defend. So they withdraw those two divisions, which were actually quite good divisions, and that's why they're needed in Palestine. They need to really bolster the troops in Palestine because the Allies, the British, particularly in the Imperial forces, are really gearing up for a big offensive in Palestine. They need those troops there. And by that time, things are quite quiet in the Stream of Valley. So it seems strategically, I mean, obviously the Germans have agreed to this because nothing happens by that time without the Germans agreeing to anything. They literally control the Central Powers by that time. So it's the quietness of the Salonika Front allows these forces to be transferred. So no, there are very few Turkish forces. There are a few Turkish units over near Monastir, and they are there until the end of the war, but they're not really operating as a large formation of Ottoman units. They're individual regiments.
Jonathan Mandelbaum asks, since most of the countries involved were monarchies, what role did family ties or rivalries between royal families play in the conflict?
Well, I mean, the great one is I didn't actually mention it, but one of the reasons that King Constantine takes a pro-German stance, basically he's married to the Kaiser's sister. So he had a lot of pressure from home, let's say, to be focused on particularly one particular side. We also have to remember, all of these Balkan monarchs are not are they're not locals. They're all from minor royal houses, quite often in Germany. I think Ferdinand from Bulgaria is Saxe-Coburg Gotha, which is the same as Queen Victoria. They are parachuted in, as seen as like a safe pair of hands. When they were parachuted in, all of the big powers actually agrees to who is going to be the king of Greece or the king of Romania or whatever. I mean, the interesting one is the king of Romania, because he's German, but the old king of Romania dies, I think, either just before or just after the First World War starts, and he's very German in his outlook, but his son, who takes over, basically says, well, I'm going to be a Romanian, and I'm going to take Romanian interests first. So he totally breaks with that. But yeah, there is a lot of dynastic stuff going on there, definitely. But a lot of it is the great powers putting a lot of pressure on those small countries. And each of those countries, as I've mentioned with Bulgaria, they have a particular thing that they want out of the First World War, as do the Romanians. So there's a lot going on there that actually sort of pushes them in the directions they end up going.
Earlier, you had mentioned Greece's focus on maritime warfare. We have questions from John and Bev asking about German U-boats used in the Aegean. Do you know anything about that?
German U-boats were definitely active in the Aegean. In fact, in 1916, the sister ship of the Titanic, the Britannic, serving as a hospital ship, strikes a mine in the Adriatic. No, sorry, in the Aegean, which was laid by a German U-boat. So they've been active. They've been active in that area since Gallipoli, trying to interdict the British supply routes through to places like Lemnos. We should also remember it isn't just German U-boats. The Austro-Hungarians are coming out of the Adriatic and into the Mediterranean. And anybody who's seen the film The Sound of Music remembers Admiral von Trapp. Admiral von Trapp was Austria-Hungary's leading U-boat ace in the First World War. He sunk a French armored cruiser, numerous other warships and plenty of merchantmen. So, he was a true war hero for the Austrian Empire. So yeah, the U-boats were a major problem. And the other issue is the Allies, of course. There are four Allied nations in the Mediterranean trying to coordinate the war against the U-boats. And they all really don't sort of get along with each other until quite late on. Which is a big problem. And the Mediterranean is right up until really late in the war is still a very happy hunting ground for U-boat commanders, whereas in the Atlantic and the North Sea, we're sort of getting a handle on it by sort of mid 1918. But yeah, the Med's a good place to be if you're commanding a U-boat. The weather's
I
nice
like
as well.
that.
You can come to the surface.
I like the inclusion of the pop culture history as well, as did a few folks in the chat. We have one attendee asking about one of your particular slides. They are asking about the equipment on a wagon that looks like an upside down rowboat. What is that?
Oh, I think that's half. Let's see if I can find it. I think it's half a pontoon. Yeah, I think that's half a pontoon. So a pontoon bridge, so a temporary bridge for crossing a river. So that's half of it. You bolt two halves together, float it, and you put the bridging platform over the top. So I mean, this is halfway up a mountain, so I would have thought they should have left the pontoon bridge behind and probably rescued something else, but. Hey, when you're desperate, you're probably not thinking straight, and the RAF are strafing you as you try to retreat on these small mountain tracks back to Bulgaria.
Clive Harris asks, did the large fire at the Saloniki have a lasting impact on Allied logistics?
Oh yeah, it did. Well done, Clive. Well done for mentioning that. That's middle of August, 1917. It's very much like the Great Fire of London. It started in somebody's kitchen and just swept through the centre of the city, burnt the heart out of the old city. So if you go there today, there are very few buildings that survive that soldiers would actually recognise. The Allies did concentrate, unsurprisingly, their firefighting on the docks where most of the supplies were. So for the Allies themselves, it didn't affect them logistically. It did burn down some of the warehouses, etc. So it made it slightly more difficult to use the harbour facility to move the supplies forward when they came off the ships. The main thing it did was it caused a paper shortage for the army, which meant that the vast amount of paper that was produced by the British and the other armies during the war, in terms of operational orders, documentation to do with attacks, plans, et cetera, it was quite hard to find enough paper to write all this stuff on. And you find that later in the war, they start writing or start printing on both sides of every piece of paper. Early in the war, you notice that most things are just printed on one side. It's quite noticeable later in the war. And there was an army newspaper called Balkan News, which the British Army produced. And it used to be 8 pages. After the fire, it went down to 4 pages.
For our last question, an attendee asks, beyond your book, are there suggestions for reading for those of us looking to go on the battlefield tour this fall?
Yeah, well, obviously, starting with my book is the best place to start. There's a if you want to get a really good book for the sort of political, diplomatic, strategic overview, Alan Palmer's book from the 60s, The Gardeners of Salonika, is excellent. That's really good. With Alan Palmer writing that high level stuff, it meant when I wrote my book, I didn't really have to worry about any of that. I could just concentrate on the army experience itself. So that's a very good volume. Others, I would say there's a book that's come out recently called The Macedonian Front, by John Lewis, which Helion Press put out. That's good because it gives an army level overview of all of the Allied contingents. So there's quite a lot in there that are Serbians, Italians, and French in particular. And John actually went to some of the original sources, especially French and Italian ones, to actually pick up a lot of that. So that's a very good recently published source as well.
Thank you for all of those additional resources. Thank you for a great lecture, and thank you, friends, for joining us. If you enjoyed this program and you're eager to learn more, or if you'd like to attend the battlefield tour in September, tune in on Sunday, April 14th at 2 p.m. Central for a talk with Clive Harris, guide and co-owner of Battle Honors. He's been leading the museum and memorials battlefield tours across Europe and Asia for over a decade, and he is such a captivating storyteller. This is something you won't want to miss. Again, this year's battlefield tour will be hosted this fall, September 13th through 18th, and registration closes on Friday, April 19th, so save your spot soon. Take care, be well, and have a great rest of your weekend. Thank you again, Alan.
No problem. I hope you come on the tour, people.